I am sitting in the very spot where I do most of my wedding ceremonies. I stand here, the couple's behind me. This light board is not in place usually during the wedding ceremonies. And one man and one woman commit their lives to one another. And it's a beautiful ceremony, and it's one that I enjoy being a part of. But we're living in a day and time where the definition of marriage has certainly been broadened. And there's a lot of confusion. And it's why that I believe the question about sexuality and gender identity is becoming the most frequently asked question to pastors, churches, leaders. What do we do about that? In fact, when we ask people to submit their questions to us as a part of creating this curriculum and sermon series, one of the first questions that came in literally read, "My friend at school is gay. What do I do?" What I love about the question is it points to relationship, that this person cares about the person, but it also points to conviction. I have a belief about that that causes me to feel tension about how I properly respond. So in quick form, I can tell you that there are three answers that come to mind and to the question of what do I do? And that is love, learn, and lead. Love, learn, and lead. Love is the absolute most important response, because when it comes to even us and me, whatever the issue is, if there's something that I'm off base on in my life, I still am changed and transformed by the love of the Savior. I'm reminded over and over again, Romans 5:8 says that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I'm reminded of the encounter that Jesus had with a woman caught in adultery, and he said, "Neither do I condemn you. Now go and leave your life of sin." He loved her where she was, and we cannot make a difference in someone's life absence of love. And so when there's someone we care about that maybe is struggling with a certain issue or is living a life choice that is contrary to what the Bible says, we cannot remove love from that equation. In fact, we must lean even harder into love. Love is vitally important. Jesus said this over and over again. He set the example for it. He walked into the mess with love. He didn't walk away from messes. And he totally made this point very, very firm to religious leaders. In fact, he told a story once where one Pharisee, a religious leader, a Jewish religious leader, was praying and saying, "God, I thank you that I'm not like these people who are lost and who are sinners. I'm thankful I'm not like them." And then he talked about another man who was a tax collector, one of the most hated people in Israel culture. And that person was praying and he couldn't even raise his eyes towards heaven, and he beat his chest and he said, "Forgive me that I'm such a sinner." And Jesus said, that person is the one that is approved by God. That is the one. And so we're reminded that anytime there's an issue, anytime we're dealing with someone who lives life differently than us and maybe completely different in ways that we don't even know how to handle, the love is the answer. Love is the first and most important answer. The second is learn. Learn from Scripture. Scripture is authoritative. 2 Timothy 3:16 reminds us that it is profitable. It helps us to understand God and our understanding of His design of things. And speaking of design, we go back to Genesis 1 and we see that God created humanity male and female. We see in Genesis 2 that it says, "For this reason, a man leaves his father and mother and cleaves to his wife." We see right there at the very beginning of the Bible, and you can keep on reading all throughout, and you will see how clear it is that God designed sex to be one man and one woman committed to each other for life. There's a passage in Romans 1 that is just very blunt about how God is not okay with a man lusting after another man, a woman lusting after another woman. And the Bible talks about the depravity and the sinful depravity of humanity, and that is an indication of that. Speaking of learning, because so many people I care about have identified sexually either gay or bi or maybe even trans, I've wanted to learn more and more about this. Two of my favorite authors are Rosario Butterfield and Christopher Yuan. And when I read their stories, they're very, very powerful. And I am reminded from Rosario's study that the way her life became transformed by the gospel of Jesus Christ is she was befriended by a pastor and his wife. And she said, they accepted me right where I was, but they didn't approve. And then she encountered Romans chapter 1, that passage, and it convicted her. And it was the beginning of a transformation in her life. And then Christopher Yuan, his parents weren't Christians when he came out as gay, and they shunned him. But once they accepted Christ and followed Christ, they actually loved him where he was even better. But they also pointed him to the gospel of Jesus Christ. He ended up in prison because of drug dealing, and he saw a Bible on the top of a trash can, and he began to read it. And God used the scriptures and the love of his parents and the prayers of many other people around him to show him the gospel. Several weeks ago, months ago, we did a curriculum and a sermon series called Three Circles. This diagram of the three circles comes to mind when I think about this issue of sexuality. See, God designed sex to be one man, one woman for life. However, sin entered the world, and what sin has always done is created brokenness. And in our brokenness, we try to figure out life the best way we know how. I call it we squiggly line, and you can see the squiggly lines coming out of that brokenness circle. And that, I think, is a truthful picture of what we're dealing with today. It's accurate. There's just so much confusion when it comes to sexuality and now even gender. I believe that we're going to have a generation of people that one day will become fed up with the chaos and the confusion, and they'll be hungry for the truth. And that brings me to the third thing. Not only do we love and we learn, but we lead. And maybe a better way to say that is we get ready to lead. We get ready to point people to God's design. We point people to the gospel that if you would just follow Jesus and do life his way, he will lead you into recovery from your brokenness and into a pursuit of his design for your life. One of my favorite quotes from Christopher Yuan is he says, "The sum of your desires is not your identity." He says, "I am not gay or ex-gay or even heterosexual. I am in Christ. That is my identity. My identity is in him. It has nothing to do with my former or even current sexuality." That is the gospel truth that we need to be proclaiming to our culture, to our friends, to our neighbors, to our family members, that you are not the sum of your desires once you turn your life over to Christ. People believe that that is their identity, and because of that, we can remain in brokenness. So as you discuss this together as a group, one of the things that I believe is the right next step is to pray. Pray for ourselves, that we don't become too judgmental, that we actually love the way Jesus has called us to love, for us to learn and know more and to see things the way God sees them. We need to pray for ourselves. We need to also pray for the people that we know and love and care about that are dealing with sexual and gender confusion, to pray for them, not like a Pharisee, like we're better than them, but to pray as fellow sinners that we want them to not remain in brokenness, for them to hear the voice of God and for God to use us to lead them into his gospel and design for their lives. And maybe you're in a group right now and you have been personally struggling with same-sex attraction or sexual or gender confusion. Pray to God about that. And I believe if you come humbly before God with open hands and open hearts saying, "God, I want to know your design and plan for my life, and I commit to following you in that," I believe you'll begin to experience a love, a joy, a peace, a newness of life that you've never experienced before. Enjoy discussing this together. Enjoy praying together. And let's remember that the Bible, the Word of God, is our source of truth, and that God wants to lead us into his design for our lives.